pig, pig. Pig, pig, pig. Dog, dog, dog. Dog, dog, dog. Dog MacArthur.
He's a tough old guy.
Dog MacArthur.
With a strong reply.
Dog MacArthur.
He's the one who slapped the Japs right down to their size. When he made a stand,
Dog MacArthur,
just the way he'd planned,
Dog MacArthur,
all the world said hip hooray, MacArthur's okay. He gave them an awful licking,
Dog MacArthur,
and he kept his soldiers sticking. When he trained his gun,
Dog MacArthur,
on those rising suns,
Dog MacArthur,
they began to flee. Yeah, man, MacArthur is grand.
$130 million Americans are behind you, Douglas MacArthur. 130 million Americans are praying for you, Douglas MacArthur. We're making tanks and more tanks. We're sending Yanks and more Yanks. We're building planes and more planes. Dig in, Doug, dig in, old man, and hold them, hold them. You, Douglas MacArthur, are showing the American people what you and your gallant men are made of. God bless you and your soldiers, General Douglas MacArthur.
And happy Saturday night. Welcome to the week ending February 7th, 1942. My name is Henry Chapp, your host. And tonight we are going to listen to Plays for Americans, the Jack Benny program, Any Bonds Today, starring Henry Fonda, the World News Roundup, and the Green Hornet. It all begins after we take care of a little business. If you are enjoying these World War II era radio programs that I share every Saturday night, why not consider becoming a patron on our Patreon page, World War II on the Air and in Print, Old Time Radio and News. The link is in the comments section to this video. For $2 a month or a mere 50 cents a week, you will get a daily dose of World War II Old Time Radio presented in chronological order according to the day of the week the programs aired. For example, shows that aired on Sunday back in the old days are shared on Sunday as we reconstruct radio schedules. Now, if you really want the virtual experience of living in a major Midwestern city on the United States home front during the war, check out our $5 a month premium tier. There you will get a complete newspaper and nearly a complete newspaper on Sunday due to the size of the newspaper and the amount of space Patreon allows per post. Just about every day. In that tier, we also share veterans interviews, documentaries, classic movies, and sometimes I will share newspapers and radio broadcasts that are outside of the World War II era. Go over there and sign up for a free one-week trial. If you don't care for what you find there, just cancel before the week is over. Once again, that page is World War II on the Air and in Print, Old Time Radio and News on Patreon. The link is in the comments section of this video. Just a quick note, I did decide to charge a small fee of $2 a month for the Old Time Radio on Patreon. I looked at some comparable pages on that platform to see how they were set up to come upon the price. I feel that is more than fair for the time it takes to search this stuff out and put it all in order. It is a never-ending process as new stuff turns up weekly. The first program that we are going to hear tonight is Plays for Americans. Johnny Quinn, USN is the episode title. This program was a sustained program, and it was written by Arch Oboler. Many of you know Arch Oboler from his horror programs, such as Lights Out. He did write a lot of straight dramatic shows as well, and this is a great example of one of them. The time that this program aired over NBC was 3:30 in the afternoon. What stations would do, or what the government would do, is that they would buy time in undesirable time slots and place patriotic programming or programming to inform Americans about the war effort. It's kind of a propaganda piece, really, but it's still a pretty cool program. By the way, when I say 3:30 in the afternoon, that is central time because I'm based in the Chicago area. So if you were in New York, it would be 4:30 in the afternoon. And then following Plays for Americans, we have the Jack Benny program and the Frightwig Murder Case Part 2. And he has a guest star on this program. That didn't very often happen during this era of the Jack Benny program. His guest star tonight is Humphrey Bogart. Let's give these two programs a listen. I see the dial is glowing on that old tube radio. That's our time machine. Here we go.
The National Broadcasting Company presents Plays for Americans by Arch Oboler. As a further contribution to national defense, NBC brings you a limited series of new plays dedicated to people of goodwill everywhere who believe in the inherent dignity of man, who fight together now for life, liberty, and happiness for all. This is a war of men and ideas, and these will be plays of the men and the ideas that make up our America of today. As the first of this series, we bring you the talented Miss Olivia de Havilland in a new play, Johnny Quinn, USN.
I'll tell you of pleasant things. The way your father looked, the way he talked and walked and laughed, and what he thought. Your father was born in a little place called Far Harbor, in a cold little sea-swept town in Maine. He died on a day when the sun was very warm and very bright in a place they call Pearl Harbor. Let me tell you. I think he must have been a very funny little boy, your father. I didn't know him then, of course, but I've seen pictures of him at 7, standing as if he had a board against his back, and his eyes kind of popping out because the collar of his Sunday suit was so very tight around his neck. But I'll tell you something else. Even in that silly old picture, and even though he was a very small boy, there was something in his face that said,
"What's it all about? What's it all about?"
Hey, what'd you say, Jenny?
I said, what's it all about?
About taking your picture, that's what.
Why?
Oh, now you hold still. Blame flash powder. Because your mother told me to make your picture, that's why. Now stop twisting. Look at the birdie.
What birdie?
Oh, stop talking. Steady now, steady.
Why does my mother want my picture?
Oh, for land's sakes. You think these wet plates don't cost money? What do you think she wants your picture? Because mothers are darn... I mean to say, because she figures you'll never amount to a darn. So she wants to have a picture to prove you did one thing in your life that you were supposed to do. Stand still for a couple of minutes in front of a camera.
But why does she want
now,
me...
Now, Johnny Quinn, you stop asking whys. Whys. Just stand there and get your picture to...
Always, yes. Always wanting to know why he had to do things. That was your father at 7. That was your father at 17 when I first met him. High school.
Here, Ann, I guess these are the seats. 6 and 7. I'll go first.
All right, Oliver.
Gee, we're so late. Oh, pardon me. Come on, Ann.
I'm with you. Pardon me.
Excuse me, couldn't we get by there? Yes. Beg your pardon.
All right.
Here, Ann.
Yes.
You here, me here. Oh, gee. Weren't we lucky getting 6-12 seats?
Yes, we were.
Gotta find out what the score is. Yeah, I wonder if anyone...
7-3 there, favor, beginning of second quarter.
Oh, thanks, Bella. I sure appreciate... Oh, hi, Johnny.
Hi. How about introductions?
What? Oh, yeah, sure. Ann Griffith, Johnny Quinn.
Hello.
Glad to meet you. Johnny Quinn. I've heard that name before.
Have you?
Ann, look at the program. That Edgewood bunch sure got the weight on us. Look, here it says...
Wait a minute, Oliver. John, why should I know your name? Are you somebody important?
Ann, look, the program, it says...
Oliver, please don't keep interrupting me. John, Johnny, I've just gotten back to town. We've been traveling. What do you do at school that's so terribly important?
You better watch the game, Ann. I'm taboo.
What's that? Yeah,
no touching, no speaking to, no see.
But why?
Look at the scoreboard. There's your answer. The guy won't play football. How do you like that?
Johnny, is that true?
Yeah, sure. What do you keep looking at me like that for?
I don't know.
Will you meet me after the game?
Oh, no, I couldn't. I'll...
Come on, meet me. I want to talk to you. Yeah, I want to talk to you.
And that was how I met your father. After the game, we met and walked.
Cold?
No. You?
No.
Walking too fast?
No.
Johnny?
Yeah?
You asked me out to walk and talk, but we just walk.
Why talk?
Johnny, why are you so old?
What?
You're not like any of the boys I've ever met. You're not much older than I am. Why do you act so old?
Wind's getting bad. I think we better go.
No, Johnny, no. You've got to tell me. What's the matter? Please, please tell me. Just walk and tell me.
Tell you what?
Who you are and why.
Well, I'm just Johnny Quinn.
No, please, you know what I mean. Tell me.
Well, my father was what everybody called a swell fella. He never asked questions. Somebody'd come to him for a loan, he'd give it. Sign a note, he'd do it. Buy a drink, he'd buy it. Swell fella, everybody said. But when he got killed when I was 11, they took the house away and everything away. My mother had to go out and do day work. There wasn't enough of that in the little town where we lived, so we came here. She's still working. Yeah, I work too. I got this afternoon off. And I don't want to go to school, but she makes me. I don't play football because I haven't got the time. My father never figured things out, but I'm going to all my life. I got the right to ask questions. I got the right to know why I do anything before I do it. I've got a right to know what's in it for me. That's all there is to it.
That's what your father told me. I've got a right to know what's in it for me. I didn't see him much after that. He went to classes and right after them went to work. Didn't have much time for girls. And I didn't have much time for thinking of him, studying and just growing up. But I did think of him every once in a while. His thin, hard face and the way his jaw was always tight, as if he was expecting life to hit him and wanted to be ready for it. And then I heard that he'd left school. I didn't see him again for 3 years. We met again at another football game.
Third down and 5. Quinn substituting for Parkson.
Ready? Who was that they just sent in?
What'd you say?
That substitute. Who is he?
Oh, that's Quinn, third-year man for state. Paper said he was hurt. I wish he was. We'd have a chance. As it is now,
the things... Your glasses, please.
Well, sure, but say, he's not that good-looking, believe me. Believe me.
Through the glasses, I saw... It was Johnny, all right. Johnny Quinn, who said he wouldn't play football. I sent a note down to the dressing room. We met after the game. He looked quite prosperous. And he had a car.
Enjoy the game?
Yes. You're very good, aren't you?
Lucky.
No, good. They were right wanting you to play for them, Edgewood High School.
All right, I'd forgotten.
Why did you change your mind, Johnny?
About football?
Yes.
Simple.
Is it?
They pay me, the alumni, tuition and 60 a month.
Oh.
I needed college training. I'm getting it at the price of running a few touchdowns. Where'll we go?
Johnny, I want to ask you something else.
No, wait a minute. You've forgotten.
What?
Me. I'm the question asker. I want to know how you've been and what you've done. How did a skinny girl turn into someone so beautiful?
I want to know about your mother, Johnny. Is she all right?
She died last year.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No reason to be sorry. She lived a hard life.
And you still think you're hard, don't you?
Sure. I'm out for Johnny Quinn.
I don't believe that.
You better start believing it.
I wouldn't like that, Johnny Quinn.
No? Well, that'd be just too bad. Yeah, just too bad.
He said that, your father, to me. His lips said it. But his eyes... We didn't meet again for another year. This time it was at a party.
And now, my dear, I want you to meet a man to remember. He gives no quarter and asks none. Johnny Quinn. Johnny, this is...
I know.
You've met?
Yes, we met.
Well, forgive me. Do forgive me.
How are you, Johnny?
I'm fine. I see you are. So we...
What's the matter?
I just heard myself asking you if you'd like to go off someplace and talk. That's what we always do, isn't it?
Yes.
Look, I've got some tickets for a concert. Someone gave them to me. I didn't want to go alone. That's the kind of thing you like, so let's go. Okay? Okay.
It seemed so strange at the time. Your father wanting to go to a concert. And it was Tristan, of all things. But then... I knew so much and yet so little of him. We went. We sat high in the balcony. The music. I can hear it now. Love music. But while it played, my eyes kept going to Johnny Quinn. His eyes were closed, and his thin face was at peace. And as I looked at him, his eyes opened, and he looked at me, and he smiled a slow smile, and I loved him. I loved him, and I was afraid of him, because somehow Johnny Quinn to me was what was wrong with the world. He was the man who had nothing and wanted something and would do anything to get it, no matter whom it hurt. He was the man who had something, and to hold on to that something would do anything, no matter whom it hurt. He was Johnny Quinn. And somehow, all at once, I loved him, and I wanted to change him. And that night, he turned his head and spoke to me.
Anne.
Yes?
I tried to find out where you lived.
Did you?
Yes. Anne.
Yes?
Will you marry me?
Johnny.
I said it and I mean it. Will you marry me?
Oh. No. No, Johnny. No. So he asked me to marry him, your father, and I said no. I said no to him. As we left the concert, he was very angry.
Well, put it into words, at least. We've walked from 6 to the river, and all you've said is no. I know I haven't had time for a build-up proposing like this, but, well, I'm a sudden guy.
Not for a husband, Johnny.
All right, I've heard that. Put it into words.
Yes. I will. Do you know there's a world outside yourself?
What kind of a question is that?
I'll ask you another. Did you see today's headlines?
Headlines? Sure, of course I did.
What were they?
Why, Chamberlain got back from Munich today.
And what does that mean to you?
Should it mean something?
I'm asking.
All right. So they sold out the little guys. So we'll have peace for a while. So what? That's the way the world is. Big dog eat little dog. So for a while, everything's quiet.
And that's all it means to you?
For Pete's sake, what should it mean?
Well, doesn't the fact that the price of Munich will be that hundreds of thousands of little Czech people, good people, are going to be hurt mean anything to you?
Oh, now, Anne, are we going to start on politics?
Politics? When you use it that way, I'm afraid I don't know what the word means. I'm talking about people.
And I'm talking about us, you and me. What have we got to do with what's happening to foreigners half the world away?
That's just it. Once you said, what's in it for me? I'm asking that question now, Johnny. What's in a marriage for me to a man who thinks of the world as a hunting ground and everybody but himself the prey to be hunted?
No, Anne.
No, let me finish. You haven't known me at all. And I hope that I didn't quite know you as I know you now. The world's too full of people like you, Johnny. People who think they can live apart from the stream of mankind and not eventually pay for it.
I talk of marriage and you stand up on a soapbox.
Oh, Johnny, for the last time, try and understand me. Oh, I know what a terrible thing your childhood was, but you're a man and you've got to have a man's values now. You're a man in a world of men where all the oldest hatreds and cruelties have come to life. And the fight against those is reality, nothing else. This is a time in a world when you've got to take sides. You're for those things and you shut your ears to persecution, or you're against them and you start in fighting. Which are you for, Johnny?
The same one. Johnny Quinn.
And so I went away. And I didn't see your father or hear from him until a few months later when I got a letter from him. I read it. And at first I couldn't quite believe.
So, there it is, Anne, right on the line. I've joined the Navy. Air Force.
Johnny Quinn? Navy? Air Force? Johnny Quinn a part of something? Johnny Quinn listening to anyone but himself? I couldn't believe it. Until I read the next words.
No, Anne, I haven't got religion. Just being smart. You see, I figured out that aviation is going to be the ground floor to what you apparently don't care about. Cash in the bank. Since the Navy will pay for my training and a salary besides, well, here I go. Yep. Still dog-eat-dog Johnny. You know, I couldn't quite answer you that night you lit into me. I never was much good at off-the-cuff answers. But maybe I can put it into words right now. What's wrong with the world is not the ones like me who say, this is my life, let the other fellow take care of himself. No. What's wrong is your kind. The ones with their heads up in the nice pink clouds. The ones who talk truth and honor and justice and forget the plain fact that the only thing that matters in life is cash in the bank. So it's off I am to a nice, cozy little session at the taxpayer's expense, Anne. When they've taught me all I want to know, I'll be back to call on you. Maybe by that time, you'll be off your little lace-trimmed soapbox and ready to listen to good common sense.
That's what he wrote me, your father. You'll be off your lace-trimmed soapbox. I put the letter away and knew that I had to shut my mind and heart to every future thought of Johnny Quinn. I tried to. And then one day, the doorbell.
Hello, Anne.
Johnny.
I'm cold.
Come in.
Anne.
Your uniform. Very nice.
I wanted to see you very much.
I'm going out.
With me?
No.
Then listen, just a minute. I leave for Hawaii tomorrow.
Hawaii?
The squadron. We're ordered out.
Oh.
Anne, look at me. All the things you talked about, being part of the world and having to do something about it, I sort of believe that now.
Johnny.
Sounds crazy, doesn't it? But you've been in my mind so much, I guess your ideas climbed in, too. Anne, before I go, marry me. Say it, Anne. Marry me.
Marry me.
That night, we were married, your father and I. And the next day he went away. And just before he went, he said something to me.
Well, Anne, it's just a minute.
Yes.
I think I better tell you something.
What?
Well, I may be gone for quite some time. I mean, before I can send for you.
I know that.
It might be some time.
Why do you keep saying that?
Well, because I'm going out there for a purpose. I want to get all I can out of it for myself. Having you out there might slow me up. Anne, that's just what I want to say. I haven't changed. It's still Johnny Quinn first and then the rest. What I told you yesterday... Well, I wanted you so much, I just told you what you wanted to hear, that's all.
Bogart!
I wanted you to know that because I wanted to be fair. Well, aren't you going to say something?
Bogart!
And the train.
Yes, the train. Get on the train, Johnny Quinn. Get on it and don't ever come back to me. I don't want you. Ever. 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 When I started to tell you all this, my son, I told you I'd talk of pleasant things. This isn't, is it? A woman marries a man for what he says he is. And then he isn't. The train went in a moment, and he went. And then the only memory of him were the letters that began to come. The letters that I didn't believe. And now, December 7th. I'll tell you about that. It was early in the day. The telephone rang. Hello? Hello?
This is long distance. One moment, please.
Who?
Ready with New York. Go ahead, Pearl Harbor.
Hello? Is it Mrs. John Quinn?
Yes.
Just a moment. Go ahead, Lieutenant.
Hello? Hello, Anne?
Yes.
How are you, Anne?
All right. You?
Well, that's why I phoned you.
Johnny, you all right?
Oh, sure, but my letters. Anne, you never... Well, gosh, tonight I just couldn't sleep. I just had to talk to you. Anne, I'm not going to tell you how much I love you. I do, but there's something else I want to say very much. In all these months I've been stationed out here, the Navy... I mean the men. Anne, I want to tell you...
Johnny. Johnny. Hello, Johnny. Operator. Operator, we're cut off. I was talking to Hawaii, someplace in Hawaii. Pearl Harbor.
Sorry, the line's been temporarily disconnected. Sorry, the line's been temporarily disconnected.
I hung up the phone. I sat there. I waited. He'd call me back. He'd tell me what he started to tell me. I waited. He didn't call. The hours went by. He didn't call. And then a radio across the hall.
Pearl Harbor.
Pearl Harbor? What of Pearl Harbor?
Japanese treacherously attacked Pearl Harbor.
Attack? Pearl Harbor. Johnny, I went back to the telephone. He'd call. He must call. He never did. But let me tell you what he did do, son. On that December 7th. The enemy, while talking peace and friendship, suddenly began to bomb and burn. And Lieutenant Quinn took off in his plane and went up high into the air and saw a formation of enemy bombers down below and dove down through the sky and crashed the enemy. and died. Just that, my son. The enemy, one plane, and Johnny Quinn. Men have a word for that. Heroism. Before this war is won, there'll be other wives and mothers to cry for and be proud of that word. But your father's dying was a special thing, because what he did was how he told me what he wanted me to know.
Anne, I want to tell you. Anne, I want to tell you.
Sorry, the line's disconnected. Sorry, the line's disconnected.
I know what Johnny wanted to say. I know it as clearly as if I'd been right there next to him that moment before he turned the plane down toward the sea.
Anne, let me tell you what I've got to tell you. They broke the phone connection, didn't they? Well, no matter. Now I can say it. All my life, I thought it was just Johnny Quinn against the rest. And what I got was mine, no matter how I got it. And then I got you that way, and didn't have you. And then I joined the Navy, and didn't have that either. But why, I asked myself, why? I'm smarter than the rest. Why should they who have nothing have something? And I'd take what I want and never have it. And then I got out here and met the men of this squadron, my squadron. The way they talked and flew, and all the big and little things they did day in and day out. Suddenly I saw they weren't out of step, I was. Me, wise guy Johnny Quinn. For they were giving something all the time, and I was taking. That was the difference. But why were they giving? I tried to find that out. What percentage was in it, this giving business? Yes, what was in it that they should give and take a punch at anyone who asked what they were getting for it? And then I thought of you, Anne, and all your words I'd laughed at, hadn't listened to, hadn't understood. And suddenly, as quick as the dive I'm going to take now, I understood it all. You were part of a world, and they were part of a world. The world of all the people willing to die for something bigger than themselves. Yes, you were all in step with every man and woman and kid who'd ever stood up under the whip, or charged across a no-man's land, or died in a concentration camp, or hung upon a cross. Yes, you believed something bigger than the world itself. You believed that every man who stood up for the right to be a man was your brother, that every woman who spoke for freedom for her children was your sister, that every child born under God's son was your child. Remember? Which side are you on, Johnny Quinn, you said? The side of those who hide and say, let me alone, the fight's the other fellas to win for me? The side of stabbing in the back and slow starvation for the children and the gangsters standing on the backs of all the little peoples? No, Anne, not that side. Your side. The side of dying, maybe, but living in that dying. Your side, Anne. Yours, 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 yours.
So, my son, I've told you of your father, the way he walked and talked, and even what he thought. That's all there is to say.
Why, Mrs. Quinn, are you still awake?
Yes.
And whom were you talking to?
My son.
Oh, don't you think you'd better wait until tomorrow, when he's born?
Yes.
Well, good night. Sleep well.
Good night. Good night, my son. Good night, Johnny Quinn.
I have just heard Miss Olivia de Havilland in Johnny Quinn, USN, the first of a limited series of new radio plays by Arch Oboler. The National Broadcasting Company brings you these dramas as a further contribution to national defense. Miss de Havilland appeared through the courtesy of Warner Brothers and the Hollywood Victory Committee for stage, screen, and radio. With Miss de Havilland was Alfred Ryder. The original music was composed by Dr. Frank Black, who conducted the orchestra.
J-E-L-L-O.
The Jell-O program, brought to you by Jell-O and Jell-O Pudding, starring Jack Benny, with Mary Livingston, Phil Harris, Dennis Day, Rochester, and yours truly, Don Wilson. The orchestra opens the program with Call Out the Marines. Grandma's day, when Grandma wanted to serve the folks a particularly fine dessert, the dessert she chose was pretty apt to be rich, shimmering Jell-O. And today, housewives still reach for that familiar red-lettered package, still depend on Jell-O for their most tempting treats. Yes, Jell-O is now more than ever America's favorite gelatin dessert, because Jell-O today is better than ever. That famous Jell-O flavor has a new vividness, a new thrill to it. It's now locked in, protected for your pleasure by a new and exclusive Jell-O process. A process that locks Jell-O's intriguing goodness right into the tiny Jell-O particles and gives you an exciting new richness and extra delicious flavor that will have you shouting hurrah for the first time you taste it. But why not prove all this for yourself? Open a package of Jell-O. Notice that there's no sweet fruity aroma, no sign of escaping flavor. Then dissolve the Jell-O just as you would in making a Jell-O dessert. And notice how the captive flavor rushes out marvelously rich. Ask your grocer for several packages of Jell-O tomorrow and discover for yourself how Jell-O's new process makes Jell-O better than ever. Call Out the Marines, played by the orchestra. And now, ladies and gentlemen, inasmuch as this evening marks the halfway point of our radio season, I think it only fair that we pay tribute to the man who has contributed his invaluable services to the Jell-O Show.
Well,
a man upon whose broad shoulders rests the burden of maintaining the high comedy level of this program.
Gee.
And here he is, folks, our sound effects man, Mr. Virgil Reimer.
Hey, what is this?
Jell-O again. This is Virgil Reimer talking. And folks, I want to tell you this is the happiest
day
of
my... Wait a minute. Wait a minute. What's going on here, Don?
Well, Jack, I thought the public might be sort of tired of hearing me introduce you week after week. So for a switch, I thought I'd introduce one of the men behind the scenes.
Oh, you thought you'd pull a little surprise on your old boss, huh?
And you certainly fell for it.
I did at that. Well, Don, I've got a little surprise for you, too. Remember one day in New York when I was having lunch with Harry Von Zell?
Uh-huh.
And you got all upset about it, and I told you not to worry?
Yes.
Well, knit your eyebrows, brother. The heat's on again. Now, let's get going with the program.
Okay. Jell-O again. This is Virgil Reimer talking. And, folks, a funny thing happened to me on the way...
Virgil! Go away, will you, and stick to your sound effect.
Oh, give him a chance, Jack. After all, I introduced him, so let him say a few words.
Oh, all right. Go ahead, Virgil, but make it snappy.
Thanks, chum. Ladies and gentlemen, a funny thing happened to me on the way to the studio. I was walking down the street. And the traffic was something terrible.
Oh, for Pete's sake.
When all of a sudden, a panhandler walked up and asked me for a nickel for a cup of coffee, so I gave it to him.
Oh, fine. Now listen, Virgil.
Just then, it started to rain.
Rain? It's a wonder it didn't thunder. Now cut that out! All right, Virgil, you gave the panhandler a nickel, so what happened?
It was a lead nickel, so he took out his gun and killed me. Oh! I thank you. Oh.
was very clever, Virgil. Now get up off the floor and go back to your clinks and clanks. Oh, hello, Mary.
Hello, Jack. What's the sound man doing on the floor?
Virgil? Oh, he's just trying to be funny. Everybody working for NBC wants to be a comedian.
Well, what's wrong with that? Give the kid a chance.
Listen, Mary, comedians are born, not made. Take me, for instance. I got the biggest laughs you ever heard when I was only 3 months old.
What'd you do, make off like a fan dancer with your diapers?
No, I used to stick my feet in my mouth and roll around like a rubber ball. I can go along with a gag, sister.
Jack, you say comedians are born and not made. Now, did you get into show business as a comedian?
No. As a matter of fact, Don, I started out as a concert violinist.
You started out as a janitor at the Barrison Theater in Waukegan.
As a janitor?
Yes, I found an old picture of you and you were holding a broom.
I was holding that broom because I was cast as a witch in a Halloween play. That takes care of the broom.
Good. Now explain the dustpan.
Well, you got me in a corner again. You know, someday I'd like to broadcast from a roundhouse. Now, hello, Phil.
Hiya, Jackson. How's the old gent with the gray hair?
He's fine. I just got a letter from my dad this morning.
Phil means you.
I know who he means. Anyway, thanks for asking, Phil.
Say, Phil, how are you coming along with your French lessons? Have you learned anything new?
Oh, yes. How's our French scholar progressing?
Well, remember last week how I learned to say je mangeais la fenêtre?
Yes, you ate the window, yes. Yes, I remember.
Well, get a load of this one. Je dormais dans la encrière.
Very good, Phil. What does that mean?
I sleep in the inkwell.
What? What are you talking about? You sleep in the inkwell.
He must have had a fight with Alice.
Look, Phil, as long as you're studying French, why don't you learn something that makes sense?
Jackson, it's a tough language. I gotta take it any way I can get it.
All right, sleep in the inkwell. Eat the window. It's your life. All I ask is that you don't show off when Humphrey Bogart gets here.
Humphrey Bogart? Is he going to be on the program tonight?
Yes, we're going to finish the murder mystery we started last week. And Bogart has had a lot of experience along that line in pictures, so I thought he'd be just the right guy for my assistant.
Let me get this straight. Humphrey Bogart is going to be your assistant?
Yes. That is, he's going to be one of my assistants. Phil will be my first assistant, and Bogart will help Phil. It'll work out fine. Now, Dennis...
Yes, please?
You, of course, are going to be the murdered man, and you'll have to lay on the floor again tonight.
I figured on that, so I wore my old clothes.
You can't wear old clothes. You're supposed to be Mr. Homer J. Frightwig, a wealthy stockbroker.
Have you seen the market reports lately?
That's not the point. Anyway, take this carnation and put it in your buttonhole so you look a little more convincing. And here's another
thing. Say, Jack, he's here.
Who? Who's here? Oh, well, hello, Humphrey.
Hello, Jack. Glad to see you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that star of Warner Brothers Pictures, Mr. Humphrey Bogart.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, Humphrey, it's darn nice of you to come over here tonight and help us solve our little murder mystery.
I'm glad to do it, Jack. I heard you play last week, and I figured somebody should do something about it.
Good, good. Say, Humphrey, we'll start casting in a minute, but first I want you to meet the members of my gang. This great big fellow here is Don Wilson.
It's a pleasure, Don.
Put her there, Humphrey. Out!
Watch out, Don. He's as strong as a 3-cent cigar.
You ought to know.
Quiet. And, Humphrey, this is Mary Livingston, our little comedian. Say something funny for Mr. Bogart, Mary.
Oh, shut up.
Well, shake hands with him anyway.
Okay.
Glad to know you, Miss Livingston. Put her there.
Ouch! Mary. And this is Dennis Day, our young tenor, and Phil Harris, our musical genius.
Hiya, fellas.
Bonsoir. Come on, tally-poo, Humphrey.
Humphrey? Is that French, Humphrey? Phil. Phil, stop showing off, you know?
You know, Mr. Bogart, I took my girl to see you and all through the night, and did you make a hit with her? Did you make a hit?
Dennis.
Ah, she kind of liked me, eh, kid?
Well, she talks out of the side of her mouth now, if that means anything.
Well, that's real hero worship. I guess we can get started with the casting, Humphrey.
Say, where's Rochester? I'd like to see him.
Oh, he won't be with us tonight, Humphrey. He has a cold. He'll be all right next week, though. He's got the strongest cough medicine. Well, let's get started. You've met everybody.
What about me? Am I an old shoe or something?
Believe me, Virgil, he's not interested in meeting you. But if it'll make you happy, all right. Humphrey, this is Virgil Reimer, our great sound man.
Pleased to meet you, Mr. Reimer. I've admired your work on this program for a long time.
You see?
Okay. Now let's get on with our sketch. This evening, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to present the second episode of our mystery melodrama, The Frightwig Murder Case, or That Rug Will Have to Go to the Cleaners. Now, Dennis Day will be Mr. Frightwig, the victim.
Howdy, folks.
Lay down. Mary will be his wife, who misses him now, but didn't when she shot him. And Don...
Yes, Jack?
You're going to be Jurgen, the butler. Only this week, I wish you'd be a little more highbrow. Can you talk with an English accent?
Well, I'll try.
Good.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next time you toddle down to your neighborhood grocer, why don't you ask the clerk for a package of Jell-O?
Package?
You will find that it comes in 6 terribly divine flavors, strawberry, raspberry, cherry, orange, lemon, and pip-pip.
Don, if it weren't for the fact that you were talking about our product, I'd say that your accent was about as English as Sambo and Tambo, you know? Now, where are we? Oh, yes. I, of course, will play the part of Detective Captain O'Benny of police headquarters. Phil Harris will be my assistant. And Mr. Humphrey Bogart will be Phil's assistant. Now, in this drama...
Just a minute, Jack. Hold it. Would you mind repeating that?
Why, certainly. I said, I'll be Detective Captain O'Benny. Phil will be my assistant. And you'll be Phil's assistant.
Oh, I see. Yeah, well, I'd like to speak to you about that.
Uh-oh.
What are you on about? Why, what's on your mind, Humphrey?
Well, frankly, I don't like the idea of being Phil's assistant.
Well, all right, then you can be my assistant and Phil can be yours. Now, in this drama...
Just a second, Blue Eyes.
Well, thank you. what is it, Humphrey?
Now, let's get this straight. Here's the way it's gonna be, see? I'm the captain, Phil's gonna be my assistant, and you're gonna be his assistant.
But Humphrey...
Now, look, I don't want any trouble. I'm a nice, easygoing guy, but I didn't come over here to get kicked around.
Well, who kicked you? I mean... Did you kick him, Dennis? Did you kick him, Don?
You know what I mean. I'm going to be the captain, and that's final.
All right. And you don't have to grab my coat while you're talking to me. Now, let go. And another thing, Mr. Bogart, I'm paying you for being here on this program tonight so you can be a little more civil.
Oh, are you going to pay me?
Yeah. Well, I'm not exactly paying you in cash, but I was going to send you a lovely present. A fountain pen or something.
Now, you send me a fountain pen, I'll squirt it right in your eye.
Is that so?
Oh, Jack, let him be the captain.
What else can I do? Got a good mind to punch him right in the nose.
Well, why don't you?
Because he's carrying a gun.
He's what?
A gad. He's packing a gad. Well, anyway, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Humphrey Bogart will play the part of Detective Captain O'Benny.
I want my own name.
All right, you'll be O'Bogart. And Phil, I will be your assistant. Are you happy?
Yes.
Well, then let go of me. How many times do I have to tell you? Now, This exciting drama, ladies and gentlemen, will go on immediately after a number by Phil Harris and his orchestra. Play, Phil. Here's my part, Humphrey. Get familiar with it.
Pedal rendered by Phil Harris and his orchestra. Render meaning to tear apart.
That's a Lulu!
Virgil! Now, Virgil, get away from that mic. And stop trying to be funny on my program.
What's the matter? Do you see the handwriting on the wall?
Now, listen, Virgil. Virgil, if I have any more trouble with you, you're getting out of here. And I'd also like to get rid of Bogart.
What was that? What did you say?
I said when I was a kid, I had a go-kart. Do you mind if I had a little fun? If I hadn't given a quart of blood to the Red Cross, I'd tear him to pieces.
A quart of blood?
Yes.
You've been down there 10 times and haven't even found a vein yet.
They'll find one, don't worry. Now settle down, everybody. Let me announce our play.
Pardon me, Jack. I'm announcing it.
All right, announce it. Boy, I never saw such a ham. Ought to have my head examined for inviting him over here.
And will you cut out that mumbling?
Listen, I've been talking to myself for 20 years. I'm not going to stop now. Go ahead, announce the play.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to offer the second episode of our mystery melodrama entitled The Frightwig Murder Case, or All Through Tonight.
Had to give his new picture a plug. I like the picture, though, but what I could have done with his part, boy.
Jack, pipe down.
Oh, poof.
Now, as you may remember, last week, Mr. Homer J. Frightwig was found murdered in his den. He was shot several times. In fact, his chest looked like a well-patronized punchboard.
Boy, I'd have gotten a yell with that line. A yell.
They'd have screamed at me.
Virgil! Go ahead, Humphrey, you gangster.
Captain O'Benny was called into the case but was unable to make any headway, so this week, I will solve the crime.
I'll bet. Go ahead, you thug.
As the scene opens, we find Detective Captain O'Bogart and his two assistants.
Had to make a mistake. Had to make a mistake.
We find Detective Captain O'Bogart and his two assistants. Yeah. In their office at police headquarters. Curtain. Music. Oh, Sergeant O'Harris.
Yes, Captain.
What's new on the Fenchel robbery? Did you find out if the chauffeur had anything to do with it?
Well, it couldn't have been the chauffeur, Cap. He had an airtight alibi.
Alibis, alibis. This is the third month of the investigation, and we're no further than we were when we started. Something has got to be done, I tell you. I want action. Do you understand? Action.
Yes, sir.
Not scaring me, I can tell you that.
Now, listen, O'Harris. What makes you think the chauffeur is innocent?
Well, at the time of the robbery, he was out of town. We traced him as far as Altoona, Pennsylvania.
Altoona, eh?
Boy, what a hit I used to be in that town. Stop the show every night.
Well, what happened after he left Altoona?
Well, we traced him as far as Chicago, and then we lost track of him until last week when he turned up in Los Angeles with a blonde.
With a blonde, eh?
Shut up!
All right, but if you ask me...
There's a phone. I'll take it.
I'll take it.
I'll take it.
All right, take it. Such a little guy, I can't understand why I don't slug him.
You're a coward.
Oh, yes. Oh, well.
Hello, hello, police headquarters. Captain O'Bogart speaking.
Hello, Bogey. This is Mrs. Homer J. Frightwig.
Oh, yes, yes. What is it, Mrs. Frightwig?
Listen, Cappy, why don't you come over and investigate my husband's murder?
It's no use. I can't find any clues.
Well, drop in anyway. It's a rainy afternoon. Come on over.
Okay, madam. But I'm going to find out who killed your husband.
Well, if you're real nice, I'll tell you. Come on over.
Yes, ma'am. I'll be there in a few minutes.
Swell. Bring some olives. I've got the toothpicks. So long.
So long.
Who was that, Cap?
Yeah, who was it? Fine part I've got. Wish I had my violin with me.
Well, who was it?
That was Mrs. Homer J. Frightwig. Come on, men. We're going over to her house right away. And I'm going to solve this crime, or my name ain't O'Bogart.
Calling all cars. Calling all cars. Enjoy your ride. You'll soon be walking. That is all.
Well, here we are, Cap.
Yeah, this is the place, all right. Break the door down, O'Benny.
Yes, sir. Stand back.
Open this door, I'll break it down. Open this door, I'll break it down. Well, what are you waiting for, Virgil? Break down the door. Please.
You won't hear a single splitter until you apologize.
All right, I'm sorry I bawled you out. Now go ahead with the door.
Very good. Well, who's this?
Good evening, gentlemen. Did you ring?
Ring? This guy's the butler, Cap.
I know who he is. Now listen, you, where's the body?
That ain't a bearskin rug grinning at you.
That's Mr. Frightwig, all right. And he's laying there just the way he was shot.
Oh, for goodness sake.
Some tough guy. I bet anything he faints.
What was that?
Well, come on, Humphrey, find out who done it.
Just a minute, miss. Who are you?
I am Fifi, the French maid.
Oh, yeah? Now listen, Fee.
My name is Fifi.
Well, I'm in a hurry. Sit down, will you?
Say, let me talk to her, Cap. I speak the language very fluent.
Fluent?
Now listen, Fifi. What do you know about this murder?
Je sais rien du tout de ce meurtre. Je suis seulement la bonne ici. Et naturellement, je ne l'ai pas commis.
Oui, oui.
Je suis dans ce pays que fort peu de temps et je ne connais pas beaucoup de monde. Je mène une vie solitaire.
Oui, oui.
J'aimerais bien un rendez-vous avec un Américain. Voulez-vous me rencontrer à the corner of Sunset and Western at 8 o'clock?
What'd she say, Harris?
I don't know, but I'll be there.
So will I. She must have a friend.
Fine policeman. Why don't you go on with the case and grill Mrs. Frightwig?
Where is she?
Here she comes now!
Well, good evening, gents. Pull up my husband and sit down.
Now, listen, Mrs. Frightwig.
You keep out of this.
All right, all right. I'm going to take a look around this house, see if I can find some clues.
Now, tell me, Mrs. Frightwig, what do you know about this murder?
Grill me, Cap, grill me. What's on your mind?
Now, I want the truth. Did you shoot your husband?
Couldn't have been Cupid. There's no arrows in him.
I don't believe you killed him, Mrs. Frightwig. And we're going to stay right in this house until we find out who committed the crime.
Okay, boys, how do you like your eggs?
Say, Cap, I just heard a noise in that closet.
A noise?
Yeah, there's somebody hiding in there.
It might be the murderer. Let me have your gun.
I didn't bring it with me.
Here, take mine.
Now, thanks. Now, listen, you. We know you're in that closet, so come out. And come out with your hands up. Come out, do you hear?
Hello, fellas. Surprised?
Oh, it's you. What were you doing in that closet, old Benny?
I'll tell you what I was doing there. I can't keep it a secret any longer. I committed that crime. I murdered Mr. Homer J. Frightwig.
What are you talking about?
I killed him, I tell you. Killed him. He was a dirty rat and he had it coming to him. And I'm glad I did it, I tell you. glad.
You did nothing of the kind. You're just trying to build up your part.
I am now. Confess. Slap the handcuffs on me. Take me to jail. What are you waiting for?
What a ham. Come on, Mrs. Frightwig. Let you and I go out and have a cup of coffee.
Okay, Cappy.
I'm going with you. No, you can't go until you arrest me. I'm a killer. Do you hear? A killer. And I also committed the...
Oh, nuts. Well, I'll be darned.
Hey, where did they go?
They went out for some coffee, Mr. Frightwig.
Oh.
That stupid Bogart doesn't believe I killed you.
Well, that's the way it goes.
Yeah.
Say, do you play gin rummy?
Sure.
Well, lay down and start dealing.
Okay, hit it, boys.
Won't you be proud? Won't the family be pleased when you serve this grand dessert? Imperial Peach Mold, a swell jello treat that's bound to win you compliments galore. Yet a treat that's delightfully easy to make. All you do is simply dissolve one package of orange jello in one pint of hot water and peach juice and chill until slightly thickened. Next, fold in one cup of canned sliced peaches drained, or if you wish, a box of quick frozen sliced peaches, freshly thawed. Then mold and chill until firm. And there's a mighty attractive, mighty good dessert. Delicious blend of juicy golden sliced peaches and bright shimmering orange jello. So get a can of sliced peaches or a box of quick frozen sliced peaches from your grocer tomorrow and combine them with orange jello for a really delightful treat. But be sure you get genuine jello, friends, because jello's new locked-in flavor gives you extra richness, makes jello more tempting and delicious than ever.
This is the last number of the 18th program in the Courage Jello series, and we will be with you again next Sunday at the same time. Well, Humphrey, thanks very much for coming up here tonight. You kind of took over the program, didn't you?
I did at that. No hard feelings, Jack.
No. You were very amusing. Take him out in the alley and give him a couple of pokes.
What was that?
I said good night, folks. I always say that. Good night, folks.
Humphrey Bogart appeared on our program tonight through courtesy of Warner Brothers Pictures. The tune Call Out the Marines is from the picture of the same name.
Jell-O puddings, please. Just say that to your grocer tomorrow, friends, and see if you don't make the acquaintance of some of the swellest desserts you ever tasted. Jell-O puddings. Rich, creamy puddings made by the same folks who make Jell-O. There's Jell-O vanilla pudding. Smooth, mellow, and thrillingly rich. Tops for delicate, tempting flavor. And not only grand as a pudding, but perfect as a creamy filling for pies, tarts, and cakes. So tomorrow, when you order Jell-O, get Jell-O puddings, too. They're just like Grandma's, only more so. The Jell-O program came to you from Hollywood. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
KFI, Los Angeles.
You know, I don't think Jack Benny has had a bad program in his career.
just some great stuff. And I love it when he has a guest star on his program. Just some really, really funny stuff. His writers were great. Stick around. There's more to come. We have Henry Fonda in an episode of Any Bonds Today, the World News Roundup, and the Green Hornet. Let's take care of some business. If you are enjoying these World War II era radio programs that I share every Saturday night, why not consider becoming a patron on our Patreon page, World War II on the Air and in Print, Old Time Radio and News. The link is in the comments section to this video. For $2 a month or a mere 50 cents a week, you will get a daily dose of World War II Old Time Radio presented in chronological order according to the day of the week the programs aired. For example, shows that aired on Sunday back in the old days are shared on Sunday as we reconstruct radio schedules. Now, if you really want the virtual experience of living in a major Midwestern city on the United States home front during the war, check out our $5 a month premium tier. There you will get a complete newspaper and nearly a complete newspaper on Sunday due to the size of the newspaper and the amount of space Patreon allows per post. Just about every day. In that tier, we also share veterans interviews, documentaries, classic movies, and sometimes I will share newspapers and radio broadcasts that are outside of the World War II era. Go over there and sign up for a free one-week trial. If you don't care for what you find there, just cancel before the week is over. Once again, that page is World War II on the Air and in Print, Old Time Radio and News on Patreon. The link is in the comments section of this video. Just a quick note, I did decide to charge a small fee of $2 a month for the Old Time Radio on Patreon. I looked at some comparable pages on that platform to see how they were set up to come upon the price. I feel that is more than fair for the time it takes to search this stuff out and put it all in order. It is a never-ending process as new stuff turns up weekly. My name is Henry Chop, your host. We are taking a look at February 7th, the week ending February 7th, 1942. If you come back next week, we move up a week. We are going to spotlight, of course, the week ending February 14th, Valentine's Day, 1942. Next week, we are going to have the Charlie McCarthy Show, the Red Skelton program, of course, World News Roundup, Vic and Sade, and Dark Fantasy. So you're going to get some comedy, some news, and a little bit of horror. Now let's talk about what we're going to listen to right now. From February 4th, 1942, it's Any Bonds Today. That is our next program up. Now, this program stars Henry Fonda. He plays Abraham Lincoln, fitting because we are coming up on Abraham Lincoln's birthday. And I'm not sure if that's mentioned in this program or not. Probably not, because it was designed to be played multiple times. It's sponsored by the Treasury Department. And of course, they would want it played as much as possible. And this episode is titled The Man from Cemetery Ridge. Many of you might be familiar with this program because it evolved into the Treasury Star Parade. And the Treasury Star Parade ran well after World War II. It ran into the 1960s. It evolved into the program Guest Star. So you had any Bonds Today first, you had Treasury Star, it evolved into Treasury Star Parade, then that evolved into Guest Star. The Treasury Department always liked to produce these 15-minute programs to sell bonds. And if you're going to be on our Patreon page, you will hear a lot of Treasury Star Parade programs beginning around February 22nd or so, because the first episode of Treasury Star Parade aired on February 25th, 1941. And there's a 3-day difference in the dates because I go by the day of the week, not the date. And there are just tons of these Treasury Star Parade programs. So you are going to hear a ton of them over there. And then we have the World News Roundup. We have to figure out what is going on in the war. Got to stay informed, right? And then following that, we have the Green Hornet. Now, this Green Hornet episode is kind of chopped up a little bit. It runs about 25 minutes long. The opening theme is cut a little bit, and so is the closing theme. And there are no commercials in this, but I think it is still enjoyable. The whole story is complete, and you will note that Britt Reed, who is the Green Hornet, he is the great nephew of the Lone Ranger. Now you know the rest of the story. I don't know if that I've mentioned that on this channel yet. I've mentioned it on my old channel. I don't know if I mentioned it here. Let's turn back on this old tube radio. That's our time machine, and give this stuff a listen.
Kenny Bonds Today, starring Henry Fonda, on the transcribed program of the United States Treasury Department. By the way, have you bought
any bonds today? Any bonds today? Bonds of freedom, that's what I'm selling. Any bonds today? Scrape up the most you can. Here comes the freedom man, asking you to buy a share of freedom today. Any stamps today? We'll be blessed if we all invest in the USA. Here comes the freedom man. Can't make tomorrow's plan, not unless you buy a share of freedom today.
Some 78 years ago, an incident occurred which became one of America's milestones. An incident that is a disputed chapter in history, because no one can say without contradiction when and where and how it happened. We give you our story of that incident, the way we believe it may have occurred. Starring Henry Fonda with Bill Adams and John Brown, we present The Man from Cemetery Ridge, written for the Treasury Department by D.H. Johnson. Music by the Treasury Department Orchestra and Chorus. This is the 18th of November, 1863. An autumn afternoon in a peaceful valley of northern Maryland. It is a mild, still day. The smoky sun gleams low on harvest stubble and grazing herds. And there is no suggestion of the bitter strife that has raged for more than 2.5 years. No hint of the war until a bustling little locomotive thrusts the towering cone of its smokestack around a bend in the valley and chuffs importantly northward toward the hills of Pennsylvania. The cars behind it draped with flags and filled with men in the blue of the Northern Army. But not all are in uniform. Here in the last car, watching the passing gold and russet land from the windows of a private compartment, are two men in civilian garb. One is Abraham Lincoln. The other, younger man, his trusted personal aide, John Hay. Lincoln's eyes are somber, and his voice is weary as he says,
"John, I'm worried."
"The war, sir?"
"The war is more than a worry, John. This is another matter. I'm afraid I'm going to cut a mighty sorry figure up there tomorrow."
"Oh, I wouldn't say that, Mr. Lincoln."
"You're too loyal, John. I might as well face the facts. Any words of mine are going to sound mighty shoddy after Mr. Everett's speech. Have you read what he's going to say?"
"No, sir. I know he sent you a copy."
"Well, I have it here. It's a beautiful piece of writing."
"Why not? They gave him 3 months to write it. They let you know 2 weeks ago as an afterthought, with a message to Congress to prepare a war going on."
"That doesn't matter, John. I fear I couldn't have done this well if I'd have had 2 years. Let me read you a little of this. Oration to be delivered by the Honorable Edward Everett at the dedication of a National Soldier Cemetery at Gettysburg, November..." Here's the beginning. "Overlooking these broad fields, now reposing from the labors of the waning year, the mighty Alleghenies dimly towering toward us, the graves of our brethren beneath our feet, it is with hesitation that I raise my poor voice to break the eloquent silence of God and nature." Now, that's magnificent oratory, John.
I'll grant that. Mr. Everett is the greatest speaker alive. How long will he talk, sir?
About 2 hours, I reckon. And then they'll call on me for the dedication. Yeah, I'll make some stumbling, inane remark.
Mr. Lincoln.
Well, that's what a lot of folks say about my speeches, John. Looks like they'll have more cause than ever hearing me after Mr. Everett.
It doesn't matter what they say.
But it does. Not to me. I'm thinking of some of the folks who'll be there. Mothers and fathers and wives of men who died at Gettysburg. A lot of them blame me for the war. And when they hear me, well, they'll lose what little faith they have left in the Republic. If I could only think of the right thing to say.
May I make a suggestion, sir?
Why, of course, John.
Could you describe the battle, sir? I mean, as it might have seemed to a soldier who took part in it.
I know very little of how battles seem to soldiers, John. And my few weeks in the Black Hawk War...
But you might talk to someone who was there, sir.
Who?
The train's full of soldiers, Mr. Lincoln. There must be some who saw action at Gettysburg.
Yes, yes. I reckon it might not do any harm at that.
I'll go through the train and find someone at once, sir. I'll send him in. Oh, by the way.
Yes, John?
I have a letter for you in my dispatch case in the next car. It arrived just as we left the White House. I'll bring it when I come back.
Very well, John. Yes, come in.
Private Williams reporting, sir.
Williams?
I was asked to tell you about Gettysburg, sir.
Oh, yes, of course. You were sent... Say, wait a minute. You're Tom Williams.
Yes, sir.
From Springfield.
I wasn't sure you'd remember me, sir.
Well, I might not recognize you, Tom, the way you filled out, but I certainly remember you. A few years back, you were the noisiest boy in Springfield.
Reckon I was.
The way you used to run up and down in front of my house dragging a stick against the pickets and yelling outside my law office when I was studying up on a case.
I'm mighty sorry if I used to bother you, Mr. Lincoln. I reckon I just like to make a lot of racket.
Yeah, well, most boys do, Tom. Yeah, so you were in Gettysburg, eh? I imagine you got enough racket there.
It wasn't mighty noisy, sir. Awful quiet, too.
Noisy and quiet?
Sometimes it was like being in a terrible storm with cannon for thunder and musket balls instead of rain. And sometimes it was so still you could hear your own breathing and the blood pounding in your ears.
I didn't know that.
First time it was so awful quiet was the morning of the third day. My company was behind a stone wall on Cemetery Ridge. We could see the Rebs over on the next ridge about a mile away getting ready for something. But hours and hours went by and it didn't happen. It kept getting quieter and quieter and scarier, like.
Scarier?
I ain't told nobody but you, sir, but I was mighty scared.
I reckon it takes a brave man to admit that, Tom.
Then, about noon, the artillery opened up and it got good and noisy again. I wasn't scared no more. Then they started their advance and the guns stopped. They couldn't fire for fear of dropping shells on their own men, and we was waiting for them to get closer. 15,000 of them marching toward us across the valley, and not a sound. I got awful scared then.
What was it, Tom? A fear of dying?
No, sir. It wasn't that scared me. It's an awful thing to say to the president of a country, sir, but you're my friend.
You can tell me, Tom.
What scared me was watching them men come on. They was marching right into death, and they knew it. But they didn't even break step. You got to have something to do that. You got to believe in something. You got to think you're right.
They're brave men, Tom. And they do believe they're right.
The thing that scared me was thinking, maybe they are right. All through that awful stillness, a thought kept getting louder and louder in my brain. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe this wave of men coming on is something there's no use fighting against. Maybe what they stand for is supposed to happen.
I see.
Then the firing started, and I didn't have no more time to think for a while. And I wasn't scared no more. Then I got shot.
You were wounded?
Musket ball in the throat, sir. I fell down. Sky got kind of dark, and all the noise faded far away and stopped. It was terrible quiet then. Quieter than I ever knew it could be. But that time I wasn't scared.
Why not, Tom?
Because I figured I was dying, sir, and the whole thing come clear to me all at once like a great light. I wasn't scared no more because I knew I wasn't wrong. I realized them fellas that started this country back in 76 started something that was meant to be. It's worth fighting to keep. It's worth dying for. If the fellas that don't die take care of it after you're gone, it's got to keep on going because it's right.
What happened then, Tom?
Oh, nothing much, sir. They come and picked me up and took me away. I've got to get back to duty, sir.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, goodbye, Tom. It's been good talking to you. I'll write your mother and tell her that I saw you.
Oh, you needn't, sir. Mother knows where I am. Goodbye, Mr. Lincoln. I'll see you again.
Goodbye, Tom.
Oh, Mr. Lincoln.
Oh, yes, yes, John.
Mr. Lincoln, I went through the whole train. There's no one aboard who saw action at Gettysburg.
What?
There's no one on the train, sir, who was in that battle.
But there must... Oh.
What was that, sir?
Oh, never mind, John. Is that the letter you mentioned?
Oh, yes, sir. It's postmarked Springfield. Shall I read it?
Yes, John.
It's from a Mrs. Williams. She says, "Dear Mr. Lincoln, as an old neighbor, I know you will share my grief at the news that has just reached me. My son, Tom, gave his life at Gettysburg, July 3rd. His company was at Cemetery Ridge."
Don't read the rest, John. I know what it is.
Very well, sir.
I was asked to tell you about Gettysburg, sir.
I think I know what I'll say tomorrow, John. The whole thing has come clear to me like a great light.
Them fellas that started this country back in 76 started something that was meant to be.
67 years ago, our fathers brought forth upon this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal.
It's worth fighting to keep.
Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure.
It's worth dying for if the fellows that don't die take care of it after you're gone.
We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We are met to dedicate a portion of it as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether free.
We are now engaged in another war, a world war. This will be a long and a hard fight. Production of war materials must be doubled and quadrupled. What have you done to help double, let alone quadruple, output of our mines and factories so that soldiers and sailors may be supplied with weapons? How many dollars have you put into United States defense bonds? Double it. How many times have you bought them? Quadruple it. Make your bond buying a regular program. Buy as many bonds as you can today and every payday. Buy them at your bank, post office, and savings and loan association. Get defense stamps from your newspaper carrier boy and your retail dealer. Set yourself a quota, then beat it. Join your country in all-out defense against the Axis. Have you bought
any bonds today? Any bonds today? Bonds of freedom, that's what I'm selling. Any bonds today? Scrape up the most you can. Here comes the freedom man asking you to buy a share of freedom today. Any stamps today?
You've been listening to Any Bonds Today, the transcribed program of the United States Treasury Department for Defense Bonds and Stamps. Stars of this program were Henry Fonda and Barry Wood. This is Larry Elliott speaking for the Treasury Department.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Friday, February the 6th, and time for our morning roundup of the latest developments at home and overseas. Our reporter overseas and in the nation's capitals are standing by, and we turn first to the capital of Soviet Russia for a report by Robert Magadov. We'll take you now first direct. Just a moment, I'm waiting. I'm monitoring Moscow now. I'm not sure whether we're going to get that signal from the Russian capital or not. No, at the present moment, Moscow is not ready. We have some news dispatches here in our newsroom in New York, and we'll continue on with that while we monitor Moscow. In the Far East Indies from Batavia comes word that the Netherlands Indies High Command announced today that Japanese forces have occupied Samarinda. Now, no further details are given about the action in the town, which is 60 miles north of the oil port of Balikpapan on the east coast of Borneo. Samarinda was a feeding point for the Balikpapan oil installations, and it also is an important coal district at the mouth of the Kutai River. Many civilians already had been evacuated from Samarinda, which ordinarily has a population of about 12,000 persons, including 300 Europeans. Military circles at Batavia, meanwhile, believe that the heavy escort of 20 fighters accompanying the air raid on Surabaya yesterday indicate that a Japanese plane carrier is in the vicinity. Now, the Japanese don't have any land base within striking distance of the United Nations key base in the Southwest Pacific, thus accounting for the assumption. Nipponese fighter planes attacked a number of towns in East Java today, but no damage is mentioned. Enemy planes also have been sighted over southeast Borneo and near Medan on the east coast of Sumatra. From Singapore, we hear that 14 civilians were killed and 104 were injured in yesterday's air raids. Now, this brings the toll for the past 3 days to 77 killed and 332 injured. Our shortwave listening post has picked up reports from the Russian front this morning, indicating that a steady advance on all sectors is going on in spite of bringing up of German reinforcements. Now, on the Central Front, the Russians are continuing to force their way from the north and the south towards Vyazma and the Vyazma-Smolensk Railway. Russians have recaptured 5 more strongly defended villages in a battle which cost the Germans 5,200 killed. Russian cavalry, operating in the Kalinin sector, destroyed a number of German aircraft, 150 trucks with war supplies, and wiped out 800 officers and men. From Balboa in the Canal Zone, the Army's brand new strategic highway across the Isthmus of Panama has passed its demonstration tests. Army machines now can travel from ocean to ocean over the 48-mile route in 2 hours, and thus a third and well-separated route has been added to the canal and railway, which, up to now, had been the only avenues of heavy transport across the Isthmus of Panama. The highway was begun in December of 1940, but Army engineers took it over after Pearl Harbor, and after 14 days of terrific labor, they drove a trail across the last 7 miles of jungle-covered hills and deep ravines. At some places, the highway is still only a one-way graded trail through the dense foliage. But the Public Roads Administration now is going to lay a two-way, 50-mile-an-hour concrete highway over that route. The job must be done before the arrival of the tropical rainy season, which would speedily reduce the present trail into impenetrable jungle again. Now, engineers figure that they can get the highway paved in 2 months if they're granted a full quota of dry weather. From the Mediterranean, word comes from Rome that the Italians say the Axis forces in Libya have advanced to within 60 miles of Tobruk. Now, the fascist communique claims that Axis troops are pushing the British steadily backwards and have occupied the town of Tamimi. That's on the Mediterranean coast, about 140 miles from the Egyptian border. From Mexico City, a group of American businessmen has severed its connections with the wealthy Swedish industrialist Alex Wennergren. Now, they were associated with him in a $100 million investment project, but have withdrawn because Wennergren has been blacklisted by the United States State Department, and he's accused of trading to the benefit of Axis powers. One leader of the group says that American financiers already have been approached to replace the capital Wennergren would have invested. Now, the project includes highway, railroad, and industrial construction in strategic regions of Mexico. Meanwhile, friends of the Swedish financier say that they still regard the blacklisting as an injustice. Efforts are underway in Washington to have him reinstated. The industrialist is widely known as a friend of the Duke and Duchess of Windsor and of prominent German dignitaries, including Field Marshal Goering. He's rented a luxurious home on the most fashionable avenue in Mexico City and plans to remain there. Now, there's no indication as to what attitude Mexico will adopt toward his business activities. Wennergren also has been blacklisted in the Bahamas, where he previously resided. And here's a communique from Berlin in Germany. German airmen are credited with damaging 3 merchant ships in waters near England last night. The Nazi High Command says that bombers also made a smashing attack against railway targets on the Newcastle-Edinburgh line. And now for a report on developments. We switch you to London.
This is London. John McVane speaking. Authoritative quarters in London still don't confirm the Japanese report that the big offensive against Singapore Island has begun. Official news reaching here only says that the British have been shelling Japanese communications on the mainland, and the Japanese have done some shelling across the straits against the northern part of the island. Japanese planes are making low-level machine gun and bombing attacks against British troops. From 2.5 years of war, most Britishers have become amateur military strategists. In the clubs and the pubs and the homes, you'll hear a lot of argument about every move that the Allies or the Axis make. When things go bad in any theater of war, a lot of people now are trying to get what satisfaction they can from the assumption that in the long run and in the grand strategy, things will work out all right. In the Greece and Crete campaigns, for instance, there was a certain amount of bitter criticism. Months later, the British realized that those lost battles had held up the German drive into Russia and forced the Germans to campaign in winter when they weren't prepared for it. So today, you find a greater readiness among the British to assume the long-range view of this world war. Nobody in this island likes the battering that the Allies are getting in the Far East. They don't like Rommel's successes in Libya. But they feel that once the German army is beaten in Europe, dealing with Japan will not be a difficult proposition. The Aeroplane, the authoritative British aircraft magazine, today explains why American troops were sent to Britain. The explanation is a simple one. Only with Russian help can the Allies carry out a successful attack on Japan itself. Once Japan is conquered, their tentacles in Malaya, the Philippines, and the Pacific Islands can be lopped off without much trouble. But Russia can't help in the battle against Japan until the German threat is removed. So Germany becomes the first enemy to lick. Allied offensive preparations are much farther advanced in the West than in the East. And the Aeroplane explains that the sending of American troops to Britain isn't a dispersion of Allied strength, but a form of time economy designed to speed up offensive plans in the theater of war where we are best prepared. The American troops in Britain will release British troops for immediate offensive operations and may themselves share in a big Western offensive. The Aeroplane says that as France was once the springboard for British troops, so Britain is now the forward base for the Americans. And the paper declares that anything the Allies can do to free Russia from her engagements in the West would improve the prospects of a Russian decision to settle with Japan while she spread out like a gigantic octopus over half the Pacific and a slice of Asia. From the technical point of view, the campaign in Libya seems to have proved one thing clearly to most aircraft experts. The Allies need planes that can destroy tanks. It's being said that the planes must carry bigger guns for anti-tank work. The little 20-millimeter cannon that are standard British equipment are too small to knock out heavy tanks. And it's even being said that now something bigger than the 37-millimeter cannon is needed to break up enemy armored columns from the air. One British expert today says, "What we want is the land equivalent of the air-launched torpedo to knock out the land battleships as effectively as the sea battleships can be disposed of from the air." And he adds, "The Russians appear to have found one secret of success in the form of a rocket-fired bomb." The fact that King Farouk of Egypt chose Nahas Pasha, head of the Waft Nationalist Party, as his new prime minister, is being well received in London. The British are saying that Nahas is loyal to the principle of friendship and cooperation with Britain, and that he's the only man who can offer the prospect of political stability. Incidentally, observers here who know young King Farouk have a great deal of respect for him. He's said to be a brilliant manipulator of men and governments. This is John McVane in London, returning you to New York.
Now, a report of developments in our own nation by Earl Godwin from the newsroom in Washington.
Good morning, folks. Washington didn't score very heavily on the dramatic side yesterday in the news, and I suppose that's the reason why so much space is given to the hullabaloo hereabouts over comparatively trivial matters, such as the two friends of Mrs. Roosevelt, who have been given good, hard jobs in the Office of Civilian Defense, and the loud outcry over the fact that members of Congress have included themselves at last in the nationwide Social Security system, and by contributing a small slice of their wages, they will build up a fund which, along with government contributions, provides an annuity at age 65, I think it is. Well, it's the same thing that everyone with a Social Security card enjoys, and it will be more widespread rather than less as time goes on. And yet this particular thing, because it's members of Congress, attracts the adverse attention of a great many people, including two active senators, Capper of Kansas and Byrd of Virginia. The latter is well known for his economy crusade. A member of the House, who has spent 25 years in Congress at a fraction of the pay that he could have won for himself in practicing law, for instance, said to me yesterday, Remember, Capper and Bird are very rich men themselves. Actually, there is one reason to welcome and support the idea of retirement pay, small retirement pay for members of Congress. It is merely a part of the general scheme, this retirement pay, and from a moral standpoint, it would seem to be better than making government jobs, creating government jobs, at very high pay for so-called lame duck congressmen. There are several, I should say many, who are on the government payroll for years after having been retired by their constituents. And many of them do good jobs, particularly federal judges appointed by the president from the ranks of lawmakers. But in the old days, a congressman was defeated, and then he came back for that short session. And in that short session, his colleagues and he would legislate a new job or a new commission into being. And the defeated member got a swell job. And this day, my friends, is the 9th anniversary of the day on which that lame duck session of Congress was wiped out by the Norris Amendment. That is, this was the day on which it was proclaimed. It seems to me the two Mrs. Roosevelt appointments have not had a good press or a good radio. One reason is they've been attacked but never explained. And Representative Leland Ford of California keeps up the attack. He wants a congressional committee to look into the matter, thinks the Appropriations Committee should look into it. Ford says they are making a Roman holiday out of defense. The movie actor, Melvin Douglas, who was given a civil defense job, says he intends to organize and line up movie actors, movie writers, and all that goes along with Hollywood for their part in civil defense. And Maris Chaney, nightclub dancer, inventor of the Eleanor Glide, is working in Philadelphia alongside of old-time athlete John B. Kelly in the health and outdoor activities side of civil defense. Many members of Congress think we need more bomb shelters and less rhythmic dancers, but of course, they may be old-fashioned. Anyhow, it'll come out in full debate when the civil defense bill comes up. It'll be before the House officially, probably at noon today, and you will learn, as the debates go along, that on defenses against bombs and artillery, we are in a very bad way, and Congress will be asked to rush that $100 million for defense. Incidentally, let me give you an advance reminder to turn your clock ahead an hour before going to bed Sunday night, because the whole country goes on wartime, or victory time, wartime, the president calls it, beginning at 2 o'clock Monday morning. The only exception is the Weather Bureau, which is going to stick to standard time, and that's all from Washington at this time.
And that's the news up to this moment, ladies and gentlemen. These have been reports by Earl Godwin in Washington, John McVane in London, and John Fraser, your reporter, speaking from New York. For the latest news, keep tuned to this station.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.
With his faithful valet Cato, Britt Reed, daring young publisher, matches wits with the underworld, risking his life that criminals and racketeers within the law may feel its weight by the sting of the Green Hornet. Ride with Britt Reed as he races toward another thrilling adventure in the story, Reservoir for Murder. The Green Hornet strikes again. Of the new city reservoir. As he walked across the cluttered ground toward the concrete abutments, he noticed that the men seemed to be especially busy with one section of the retaining wall.
Looks like something's cooking over there, and it ain't good.
Hey, buddy.
Well, you better not go any further, mister.
That's okay. I'm a reporter from the Daily Sentinel. Here's my press card.
Sure, only
forget it. My insurance company says they can take all the risks they want in their payroll. So why should I worry? Where's the phone around here?
The only ones in the construction.
Never mind, buddy. You warned me. You did your duty.
Hey, wait.
I'm tired. Reporters wait for no man. I'm climbing that scaffold. I want to see this with my own eyes. They built this reservoir with knitting needles instead of T-squares. The Sentinel's going to hear about it.
Hey, what's happening to that scaffold?
Mr.
See, the Sentinel publisher's office.
Casey, this is Lowry. Where's the boss?
Oh, what's the matter, Lowry? You sound excited.
Where's the boss? Give me the boss. It's coming down around my ears.
Casey, is that Lowry?
Yes, it's Lowry, Mr. Reed.
All right. Hello. Hello, Lowry.
Boss, that ship was the McCoy. One section is caving in.
The reservoir going? This case at Dunnigan.
Yes, sir.
Dunnigan.
Here he is.
Dunnigan, Reed talking. I've got Lowry on the phone. Construction wreck at the reservoir. I have a rewrite man caught in. You got it?
Got it.
Okay, Lowry, you give it to the rewrite man.
Okay, boss.
Can you see what's going on?
Sure, I have a ringside seat. I'm at the construction shack. I can see from the window. Okay, Mr. Reed.
All set, Lowry. The rewrite man's listening. Go ahead. I'm about 200 yards away from the concrete wall. They've been sewing up one section because it had a crack in it, but it isn't a crack anymore. Hold it. There goes another chunk. You hear that? Man, it's a lucky thing there wasn't any water in that reservoir yet. Half the people in Naples Valley are getting their feet wet up to their ears. The rest of the concrete seems to be okay, but that one section, yeah, they're pulling the men away from it. Guess it's going to change. They're running like this. Looks like it's going to be more than 1 month before the governor dedicates the Naples Valley Reservoir Project after all. There'll be an investigation. Hold it. Here comes the big one. 150 tons of concrete. Going. Going.
Darkness had fallen over the wreckage of the reservoir wall. Powerful lamps poured cones of light down as men worked to clear away the debris. And slipping quietly and unnoticed among the working men was Ed Lowry. He stayed out of the lighted areas as much as possible, but his sharp eyes saw everything there was to see.
Maybe I can dig up an angle on this. Concrete walls just don't fall down and go boom without a reason. Any concrete solid enough. Certainly feels that way on my feet. Hey, what's this? Yeah. One of the sealed supports that was buried in it. It looks funny. It's got a sharp edge. Lowry, my friend, maybe you're onto something here. Now, where did I put those matches? Let's have a look at the edge of this girder. Come on, right. Come. Well, plaster me on the front page. No wonder that concrete wall caved in. Holy mackerel, this girder is... Hey, let go of me. What are you doing? What are you trying to stop?
Into doors again.
Ha-ha, very amusing. Where's the boss?
Oh, I knew you'd try to fight somebody bigger than you someday. Or was it a whole gang?
Not Casey. It was one guy with a 10-ton blackjack in his fist.
Well, that's why you didn't come back to the office last night or phone in. Fighting, huh?
Holy mackerel, what kind of a reception is this? So help me, boss, I got this while I was on the job.
You did?
Sure, I was checking over that reservoir after dark. And just when I find something good, blam, some monkey jumps me and sends me to dreamland. Didn't wake up till this morning.
Then you found something good. What do you mean?
What I said, boss. I found enough to prove that crash was no accident.
Good call. No accident?
No, sir. Not when the steel supports that are supposed to be embedded in that concrete are sort halfway through.
What?
Yes.
Gosh, Mr. Reed, and the whole state is blaming Jeff Thorndyke, saying that he's responsible.
Not if that concrete was deliberately weak.
It was, boss.
Lowry, you're going back there. Miss Case, get a photographer to go back with Lowry and take pictures of that damage. Call the police.
Whoa, boss.
What?
No dice. You'd be wasting your time.
Don't be silly, Lowry. Why would it make a front page story that would scoop the town?
Hold on, Miss Case, just a moment. Go on, Lowry. We'd be wasting our time. Why?
Because the steel girders aren't there anymore.
Go on.
When I woke up, I started to look again. Boy, somebody cleared those girders out of there like Lewis took bear. What good is a story without proof?
We'll see you now, gentlemen. This way, please.
Okay, Thorndyke, keep your chin up. I'm glad you're here, Reed. It's good to have someone backing me up. Senator just got the axe out for me. Can't say I blame him.
Caving wasn't your fault, Thorndyke.
Yes, I know the Senator
was, but someday we'll prove it.
Very much if you can prove that, Reed.
Hello, Senator.
Hello. You may go, Miss Bassett.
Yes, sir.
Well, Thorndyke, as engineer in charge of that construction job, you've managed to put me in the soup. There's only one I can say this rather publicly. You come right to the point. Did you bring along your resignation?
I can't understand what went wrong.
I'm not interested in alibis. I'm interested in results. You didn't get them.
I understand. Here's my resignation.
Now, just a minute, please. The rat deserts the sinking ship.
You bird dreamed at me, Reed.
It is. I hit this department. I'm responsible for what happens.
You're also responsible for the men under you. Yet you're making Thorndyke the ghost.
I'm putting the blame where it belongs.
You read the Sentinel. There might be some doubt that what happened was Thorndyke's fault.
Poppycock. The story cooked up to make speculation. You know, Jim.
Not from the Sentinel, sir.
There's no proof. The reporter made that story up. Can you believe
him? I believe him, yes. But he didn't make it up. I know my reporter. And get this, Shevlin. The public has faith in the Sentinel, too.
There's no time for...
Which is just what I said. You're yapping about the interest of the public. Well, get this, Shevlin. The Sentinel has a circulation that's almost as big as all the others combined. And this morning, after our story, our switchboard was flooded with phone calls.
Phone calls about what?
About the cave-in at the new reservoir. Shevlin, if you're interested in public opinion, you might be interested to know that the public does believe that story in the Sentinel. At least enough so that they don't blame Thorndyke.
Yeah, that's true.
If you want a record of their names and addresses?
No, I don't doubt you. Thorndyke, this puts a different complexion on things.
Shevlin is always sensitive to public opinion. Aren't you, Shevlin?
Yes,
Senator,
yes.
You mean my resignation?
Yes, I'm not accepting it, Thorndyke. There, in the waste basket.
I don't know what to say.
Never mind. Just go ahead and make sure the job is finished. And finished right.
It'll be done right.
I'm still puzzled about what I
did. Let's go. Can't you see the senator wants to be alone, to eat his own word? Goodbye, Shevlin. Next time, don't be too anxious to throw out a good word.
Goodbye, Senator. It'll be done right. I'll make sure it's done right. Goodbye. Go ahead and finish that job. When it's done, I'll make absolutely sure Thorndyke loses his job. I'll make it positive. Bender.
What are you doing here?
That's why I came, you fool. I don't want to be seen. You've heard Thorndyke is going ahead with the construction work.
Yeah.
Thorndyke is too good a man. If he keeps going, he'll end up with my job.
Yeah.
That puts it up to you, Bender. This time, I win a big accident, you understand. Big enough so that not even the Sentinel can keep Thorndyke in his job.
I'll be finished with the construction in 3 weeks, Senator. The water will be piling up behind the dam. A whole lot of water, Senator.
That's it, Bender. I think you understand.
Yeah, I understand.
If the water should break that retaining wall and flood the valley, there'd be a lot of damage. Thorndyke couldn't explain that.
Yeah, Senator. And besides, there wouldn't be any evidence. The water would wash away every sign. Okay, Senator, you can count on it. There's going to be a flood.
Following weeks, while the damage was being repaired and the dam completed, Ed Lowry made frequent trips to the Maple Valley construction job, and his reports back to the Sentinel were all the same. He saw no sign of trouble, but he wasn't the only one on watch. When darkness fell each night, a small man, inconspicuous and slight, prowled around the reservoir. That man was Cato, Britt Reed's Filipino valet.
Yes, Mr. Britt. I observed Maple Valley Reservoir at night, as you direct.
You weren't seen, Cato?
No, sir. Back home in Philippines, I learned how to move silent, like younger cat.
What did you find out, kid? Was there anything wrong?
No.
Why do you say it that way?
I'm not certain, Mr. Britt. But there one man, I observed him at night, act very strange.
Strange?
Nothing very definite. Only he acts like man who doing wrong. A man named of Bender.
Bender, eh?
Name is familiar?
Yeah, he's the man who told Larry to stay away when that section of wall fell. I wonder.
Yes?
I wonder if he's the one who could have knocked Larry out that same night.
Oh, it's possible, yes.
Keep watching, Cato. Pretty soon that job will be completed. We don't want anything to happen.
done, men. Thanks for your work. The Maple Valley Reservoir is a project you can be proud of.
Senator Shepard, will you close the water pipes? Take about a week to get the water high enough in the reservoir to start using it.
That's the way the weather is, Thorndike. It's raining up in the mountains. Until the reservoir fails. I just press this button?
Yes. Thank you, Senator. And thanks for letting me finish this job.
Yes. Well, here comes the rain. You'll excuse me. I'll get to my car.
Senator Shepard.
Yes, what is it?
Everything's set. This rain ought to speed it up, too.
Look around.
Oh, there's nobody to hear. Just a couple of more days, and it'll be Thorndike's finish.
He's riding high.
It'll be his finish.
It better be.
On the other side of the senator's car. Who are you?
Excuse me. I'm very sorry. Mr. Britt, I come back to apartment at once. I tell you what I hear.
You don't know their plan?
No, sir.
Rain will fill up that reservoir pretty fast.
That is true. Rain continues. I think...
Hey, we've got to find out. Check the gas weapon and the Hornet mask.
It's raining really hard, Mr.
That doesn't matter. Rain or no rain, the Green Hornet's going out on the black duty.
A few minutes later, Britt Reed and his Filipino valet, Cato, stepped through a secret panel in Britt Reed's bedroom, then along a narrow passage built within the wall itself, down narrow creaking stairs that led around a corner and connected directly with another building on a little-used, dead-end side street. Seen from the street, this building looked deserted, empty like all the others. No one could guess that within its bleak walls stood the supercharged Black Beauty, streamlined car of the Green Hornet.
Go ahead, Cato. We're going to find this man, Bender. We'll get the answer.
Cato flipped on the headlights. A photoelectric cell registered the beam, started a small electric motor. Silently, a huge section of apparently solid wall swiveled upward. The sleek black car rolled into the street, turned and headed north toward Maple Valley. And behind it, the wall once more dropped into place.
So long, Joe. Keep the change.
Did you hear from me you don't want to do this Maple Valley Reservoir job, Bender?
You'll never know, Joe. Good night.
Any what, Al?
Yeah, it'll be a lot wetter, too. A lot wetter.
Just a minute, Bender.
Hey, what's the idea of bumping into a guy this way? Dark enough to black out.
This is a gun in your ribs.
Hey, what is this, a stick-up? Who are you? That man with the Green Hornet.
Come with me, Bender.
What do you want?
Come with me. You're going to answer some questions.
It's hotter upstate than it is here in the city, Senator.
Yes, Miss Darcy. I won't need you anymore today.
Yes, sir.
What's the matter with Bender? He's supposed to call me on my private phone. Water should be pouring into that reservoir. I want to know. I tried to get him myself. He isn't home. Private phone, that's it. Hello, is this your Bender?
Lord Shetland.
Who is this?
Expecting a call from Bender, weren't you?
Bender, what? This number is private. You're making a mistake.
Bender's right here. It's no mistake. I know all about it, Shevlin.
About what?
The Maple Valley Reservoir. I want $10,000.
Who are you?
This is the Green Hornet.
The Green Hornet?
$10,000, your scheme blows up right in your face.
You can't bluff me.
Not a bluff. Remember, I've got Bender here. It wouldn't be hard to get him to talk. Make up your mind, Shevlin. $10,000.
All right. All right, at least I'm willing to talk to you about it.
That's polite. It's plenty nice, and your apple cart may not be tipped over, huh?
meet you in the valley about a mile below the reservoir where Route 22 and Highway 16 split.
I know where.
Tomorrow night at 11. Be there, Shevlin. Don't forget.
You make a phone call, yes?
All set. Tomorrow night at 11. Where is Bendy?
You give him gas from gun, Mr. Britt. He's in his car, unconscious. What do we do between now and tomorrow night, please?
Can you take care of Bendy?
Oh, I keep him unconscious till then, yes.
Good. I'll take the Black Beauty and head back to town. I want to be at the Sentinel tomorrow. I'll meet you at 11 in the evening.
Oh, where is meeting?
The junction of Route 22 and State Highway 16 in the valley here, Cato. And take care of Bendy.
Casey? 5:30. Will you come along, Mr. Thorndyke, and Mr. Reed's office?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Nice guy, Thorndyke. I like him.
I wonder if he'll get someone
down. Yeah, I hope so. Somebody ought to. Yeah. Still raining.
All day and since yesterday.
This rain has me a little worried, Reed. Maple Valley Reservoir.
Don't be foolish, Thorndyke. You have men up there, haven't you?
Well, yes, but it's something unforeseen.
Oh, forget it. Say, Lowry.
What is, boss?
I've got to head for home. I have an appointment tonight. Oh, will you and Miss Case keep Mr. Thorndyke from getting the jitters? Now that his work's done, he has plenty of time for worrying, so keep him occupied. You might join around the Sentinel. Perhaps he's never seen a great newspaper at work.
Mr. Thorndyke, you've seen everything.
Listen to that thunder. Still raining.
Give up, Casey. The guy's hopeless. Here it is, 10:30 at night. Outside of eating dinner, we've been giving him a conductor tour of the Sentinel, and all he thinks about is the weather. I tell you, Casey, that's right.
Oh, Mr. Thorndyke, I've been calling you from Senator Shevlin's office all evening. I couldn't get you, so I finally came over.
Hey, Miss Darcy, what's the matter?
Oh, I don't know exactly. A phone call came for the Senator. It wasn't on his private line, so I took it. Mr. Thorndyke, it was a man reminding the Senator to be at the junction of Route 22 and Highway 16 at 11 tonight.
The junction? In the valley?
Yes, and to bring $10,000. But the Senator was gone already. I couldn't tell him.
Oh, sister, calm down. You're all excited.
Why shouldn't I be? The man who called was a green horse. The horse?
Holy mackerel, this is a case for the police.
The police?
Joe, hold on the floor, Casey, and tell Gunnigan to get set for a page one scoop. 11 o'clock, huh? We might not make it by 11, but we'll be there soon after. Come on, Thorndyke.
Shevlin, I brought him.
You, the Hornet.
I'm in the back seat. Got a gun. How about that $10,000, Shevlin?
Oh, Hornet, it's probably too, but
I told Shevlin, money talk.
Yes. Yeah, here you are.
Thanks. You doctors come, but if it isn't all here...
It's there.
Good. I told your secretary...
What's that? My secretary?
Yes, I called this evening, just wanted to remind you. I got no answer on that phone.
She doesn't know I mixed up in anything crooked. You ruined me.
Oh, now isn't that too bad? Now that I think of it, she was a little surprised. But that's your tough luck, Shevlin. I got the money and that car coming.
The car. That was it, please. Get out of here. Get out.
I will, Shevlin, but pray.
No, no, don't shoot me. Don't
get rattled. Is this for you, Bunder, or just do my best? Miss Kato, don't keep the police your eyes. Remind me to send this $10,000 to the Red Cross, will you? Let's get to the Black Beauty.
But, Mr. Britt, I don't understand.
I don't understand what, Kato?
Even when police get here... Even when they find those two, what good is that? If not possible, they prove they are criminals.
Don't worry about that, kiddo.
But I do worry. How police know unless Senator or Senator talk? They not talk.
I said don't worry. Let's go, Cato.
sheriff's car. What's the him?
How easy a shot. Let me in there first.
How about the light, Flannery?
Say, here, I'll hurry up. Hey, the senator's out cold. I guess the Hornet beat us to the punch.
That's just right.
You clipping? What are you doing here?
Hello, Mr. Thorndike. I ain't doing nothing.
Nothing.
We come all the way out here into the valley to catch the Green Hornet, and what happened?
Nothing.
The Hornet was here, mister. He was here.
What did you say? Are we in the valley?
Yeah. Right below the Maple Valley Reservoir?
Of course, Bender.
How long's it been raining?
Since yesterday, coming down in buckets.
What's the matter with you, Bender? Poor fellow must be out of his head.
Since yesterday. We'll be drowned. That car on Creek Wall is in a cave any minute. Now let me out of here.
Yes.
Oh, it's true, I tell you. If we stay here, we'll be drowned. Mr. Thorndike, we're drowned. Now listen, you gotta believe me. I was being paid by seven, and I saw them steal support.
You what?
Yeah. I saw it all of them. Then I poured the cement in so it wouldn't be seen. That dam won't hold, I tell you.
You'll get jailed for this, mister, and Shevlin.
Who cares about jail? Well, I'll drown, I tell you. Now let me out.
Good Lord, Lowry knows what he's talking about. We've got to get to the dam. We've got to open the emergency sluices and drain the water off. If we're too late, the whole wall will go. The valley will be flooded. People will die in their sleep. Women and children, the town. We've got to get there at once.
Yeah, Mr. Thorndike. I've been trying to get loose for 10 minutes. Can you imagine some guy comes busting here wearing a mask? I tried to stop him, but he opened all the emergency sluices.
Did you say he opened the sluices?
Yeah. The water's dropped 2 feet already.
Davis, that man saved the valley. The concrete wall would have caved any minute.
Huh? You mean he... Well, he was wearing a mask. And that note, he left that note on the table.
All it says is...
Yeah, I've got it.
Thorndike, it says, I may be a crook, but I don't go in for mass murder. It isn't signed, but it doesn't have to be.
Lowry, listen. It was the Green Hornet.
And that's the way it was the week ending February 7th, 1942. My name is Henry Chop. Don't forget to support us over on Patreon. Come back again next week when we will have the Charlie McCarthy Show, the Red Skelton Show, the World News Roundup, Vic and Sade, and Dark Fantasy. Until then, let's turn off this old tube radio. That's our time machine. Good night. God bless.
This changing world, this changing scene, where is it taking us? What does it mean? As long as we're certain of each other, we know we don't have to be afraid. These changing times we rise above. We have no time for them. We have our love. And love is the only thing that still remains the same. Through all this change